Yes, hello, my name is Christian Berg. I'm the CEO of Albright Stiftung. That's a German-Swedish foundation. Not founded by me, but founded by a Swedish businessman, Sven Hagströmer, about 7 years ago in Sweden. And his aim was to get more women in the top management positions in private companies. Sven Hagström is a relatively famous person in Sweden. He founded one of the biggest banks there, Avanza Bank, the first internet bank. And he has a lifelong experience in business and finance. But he always noticed that mixed leaderships with women and men at the top were better for the companies, making better results, but also people working better together. And as an entrepreneur, he was very irritated that his fellow businessmen didn't take it as such an important question, so he decided to found a foundation, Albright, first in Sweden and then a couple of years later in Germany. Well, of course, we heard earlier today, Madeleine Albright was one of his source of inspiration. But the name Albright is actually all right. The future is all bright if you work together, but also about meritocracy. All the bright people should come to the top, if you're a man or if you're a woman. And we try to live that in Albright. Our founder is a man. The CEO of Albright in Sweden is a woman. And the CEO of Albright in Germany is me, a man, but also together with my female CEO colleague, Vibke Ankersen, so we are two, men and women. And we are working for that women and men should have the same opportunities to reach the position for which they are educated, which is not the case today. And how do we do that in practice? Well, we publish in Germany, but also in Sweden, reports regularly, and show the actual numbers of men and women in executive boards and in supervisory boards, in the listed companies in these countries. And I think that's, we heard that also today, it's very important to have the facts. It's we talk about alternative facts, but if you have the real facts, it's easier to argument. Well, then how does it look like? Well, hopefully it works, yes. This is the Frankfurt Stock Exchange on the 1st of September this year. 641 men in the executive boards, 56 women. We heard quite recently in a discussion that some male persons are afraid that they are losing positions to women. I think that is not happening in Germany, not at least now. I think the yellow are the women and the male, all the others are the men. In other words, it's 8% females and in other words, again, 92% men, 92%. It's almost absurd if you believe that skills are equally distributed between men and women. And I think there's nobody here, nobody at all, believes otherwise, another thing today. So it's quite obvious that the brightest has not been, been recruited to the German executive boards. Well, is that a German problem? Well, last spring we also looked a bit closer at some other OECD countries. France, UK, USA, Sweden, and Poland, to see if we had a German problem. And then we just studied the largest companies in each lead index, so in DAX in Frankfurt and for example, Dow Jones in the United States. And here are the companies that you normally find most women in on the high positions. If you look at smaller companies, in the middle-sized companies, it's normally much less women. So, which of these six countries do you think were having most women in the executive boards? USA, UK, Sweden, Poland, Germany, or France? Other guess? Well, you're right, USA. When you say that in Germany, you also have the answer Sweden, and then maybe France. But in fact, it's the United States. Sweden is almost there. But you can say that, of course, in one way, as you work in Germany, you have a German problem. You are the last place. But the situation is not fantastic in the other countries either. And it might be, at least if you are living and discussing these issues in Germany, it's a bit, people are asking you, why do the United States come so high on this thing? Because in Germany, you normally say that the reason why women are not getting to the executive boards is because we don't have enough childcare, we don't have an adequate parental leave system. That, in the country where I come from, Sweden, we have that. But in the United States, well, you don't have hardly any public childcare at all, and paid parental leave you don't have at all either. But still, the women are coming to the top positions. And I think the main reason, therefore, is that the companies want to have the women there. It's normal, it's natural, and it's not anything specific or complicated as is many other countries. Well, here's the executive boards. Then we have a look, we had discussed this also today, but the supervisory boards. A look is there. Well, the situation is slightly better in different countries. But here's quite interesting. Two of the countries here have quotas, and that's France and Germany. France 40%, Germany 30%. But the interesting thing for me, I think, here is that there are two countries that also have almost or over 30% without any quotas, and that is Sweden and UK. So this is always a discussion if you're for or against. Maybe you can, if you remember the last picture, so the last two countries here on the executive boards are France and Germany, and here's the one who having quotas. Maybe they introduce quotas because the situation is so bad, or there could be a discussion that we had earlier on that people tend to go, and the women tend to go to the supervisory boards instead. I had just last week, just because now we're here in Estonia, and Estonia was not a part of this this survey, but we had a quick glance at the listed companies on the Tallinn Stock Exchange. And it's quite interesting. It's not many companies, so that's not really what you can use as for all Estonian companies. But here you have comparatively many females, 25% in the executive boards, but in the supervisory boards there were very few, only 8%. Well, then well, you can say that in most European countries, although we heard that from Finland here, that it's changing and it's getting better, but in Europe, I think we have a bit of a problem here. And who is to blame for this very rather discouraging development? Well, for me, it's rather clear. It was already mentioned. It's Thomas. Thomas is the most common name in the German executive boards. And if you add the second most common name is Michael, you'll find out that you have more Thomases and Michaels than you have women. So you have 60 Thomas and Michaels and 56 women in the executive board. And if you look at the post of the CEO, you have 5% of the CEOs in German companies are called Thomas, and 3.5% are women. And the interesting thing is that Thomas tend to recruit another Thomas, and a never-ending, what we call a Thomas circle. In fact, the recruitment patterns show that executives tend to recruit copies of themselves. If you look at these pictures, you see that, as I already said, 92% are men. 76% are German. Most of them are born in the mid-60s. Not only, all of them, not 1965, but most, some in 63 or 67. 67% are located in West Germany, 32% abroad. That means that only 1% of the are educated in East Germany. So 6% out of about 700. Yeah, the education are very similar. You are a business professional or an engineer. And we can say, once again, we are now here in Estonia. Is that something, a special problem you have in Germany? Well, we also have a quick look at some of the other countries, so OECD countries. And here you see the most common names in the executive boards in some other countries. You can follow the Thomases, you can follow the Michaels, you see the Marks and the Johns and what Peters and Piotrs. Of course, these are the most common names in the boys born in the mid-60s, so maybe they will be replaced by Kevins or something else, but hopefully also by Anns and Lauras. So then next question, is that a problem? Well, of course, even the executive boards of the big companies, all people basically have the same background, the same experience. It's dangerous and could lead to very fatal decisions. No one questioned anything, basically. No one copied new radical ideas. And in a rapidly changing world, companies need much more wider patterns of experiences to be able to be innovative, to be able to change, and to avoid disasters like, for example, the fraud with the diesel engines in Volkswagen. It was a group of all, or no, only men heading Volkswagen at the time, and we have other, some other companies that also have made several disasters. It is group thing. If you are together in a group, you have all the same experience, you will think about the same things and act together in a sometimes not very good way. And we also heard that today, but diversity is profitable for the companies. Many studies are showing that profit and high proportion of women and men in the executive board is connected, and diversity is positive for results. As you see here, you have McKinsey, we've already heard, but you also have some of the national big banks, Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, Credit Suisse, UBS of Switzerland, Avanza Bank, it is not there in Sweden, and many others have shown that it's good for the companies to have women and men. And those organizations are not doing that for of any fairness aspect. They're doing that because they think that it's good for the company and it's good for the profit. And it's also interesting to see that also some of this, I want to mention especially one of them, is this Peterson Institute for International Economics, a think tank or research organization in Washington, D.C. They made the largest study until now. It was about 20,000 companies in over 90 countries in 2016. And they found out a very, very, very clear, obvious result that those companies having more women on the top in the executive board, not on the supervisory board or not as CEO, but as there's a mix of women and men in the executive board that was changing profit extremely much. And here's one of the examples from the study is that if a company had no women at the executive board and then decided to promote women or to recruit women, so you had 30%, at the same time you had an actually profit rise with 15%. And that's quite a lot if you are in the business world. So, I mean, the profit reason is one of the main reasons, of course, for the case for diversity. If you are a company, one of the main reasons you exist is to make a profit, and not to do that, it's stupid. But there are other reasons too. We're talking quite a lot nowadays about the war for talents. All companies want to employ and attract the bright young people, the top graduates from university, the innovative brains. But do you really think you're going to do that if you only have men at the top? What kind of signals are you sending to curious female applicants? You can work here, but you'll never get to the top. Or at the same time, you also send similar signals to modern men, or younger, most modern men. Because if you see this group of Thomases or Michaels, middle-aged men all together at the top, you could also maybe risk that you have a company with very rigid structures, many hierarchies, less personal freedom, less opportunity to combine private life and work. And if you are a man or a woman, you should go to another employer, a more modern one. And that's also what's starting to happen. You see it quite clear in Germany. Then another thing we haven't discussed so much today, digitalization and diversity goes hand in hand. I mean, the world is changing in a much higher tempo as before. And as a company, you have to adapt to new technologies, to new markets, and to new preference from customers, and new innovations. And in almost all the studies I just mentioned, one of the reasons for this profit gain from diversity is that the company are more adapt to change. They more can change quicker. They see the changing in societies. And if you have a company with different experience represented in the executive boards, they're much more agile. This is one of the buzzwords today. Than these Thomas-dominated boards that were maybe very successful in the past, but not maybe not in the future. And also mentioned in the other discussions, at the end of the day, you should not underestimate the signals and all male management are sending to their own female employees. Well, you're not welcome here at the top. You can work there where you stay, but not here. Here's only for us. But also, not, of course, to customers. Why should a female customer buy anything from a company wanting to have only men at the top? You see that in Germany also, that when we publish some of our reports, we also make lists, black list of companies having no women at top. And at least in social media, there's been quite a lot of discussion about boycotting those firms. And it's a pressure from the customers. And that's something I think as a company you have to take for real. And also if you have the, yes, another type, if you're sitting in a company, having the possibility to choose from different proposals for consulting firms, recruiters, law firms, why choose a team or a company that presents a team with only men? Is that a good team? Is that the best team? There are many people I've heard that they're not deciding, no, we don't accept that. We have a team with men and women if you want to have you as a consulting firm, for example. What's also coming up is more pressure from investors. Some of the biggest pension funds are looking more closely at diversity in top management before they buy shares. We also had that earlier today. But for example, BlackRock is one of the world's largest investors, are putting pressure to the firms that they should invest in. They must have women in top in the management, or it's a mixed management. Well, okay, if that's good for the diversity, how do you get there? Well, that's, I guess it's no really very easy way. There's no short list, but we have worked with a lot of different companies, and there's something that we see that all is coming up. Well, it must come from the top. The CEO and the executive management must see diversity as top priority. You can, I can have a diversity manager, you can have female networks, all the things are not bad. But if the CEO and the board only see diversity as something nice to have, you will don't have big changes in the company, and not nothing will happen. Instead, in a successful company, you see that the CEO and the top management are putting pressure on the middle management that they should recruit and promote women. In some companies, for example, in Vattenfall in Sweden and also in parts of BMW in Germany, the bonuses from the middle management are connected to how many women they promote and see that they get on a higher position in the company. Another very important thing, as already also been said recently, role models actually promote women to the top. Make it clear for everyone to see that women can reach the top. It's good to see for the women in the company, but also good for the men to see that your female colleague could suddenly be your boss if you didn't know that before. You should actually hire more women, promote more women, and lose less women. Recruitment, who is responsible? Is it Thomas who recruits, another copy of himself? Or do you have a professional recruitment team with men and women doing together? Are your company attractive for young talents? Promotion, are the role models, keep the women? Well, I only have two left. as also said, internal targets are very important, and you should not only have the targets, of course, you should measure them at all at the end. The company culture, what kind of culture you have, or have you have transparency, flexibility, mobile work, and at least you should also involve the men. It's not an issue only for women, it's an issue for women and men in the company to make it all better. Thank you.